Are you a thoughtful leader? Maybe you are. Maybe you think you are. Let's find out. I'm Mindy Gibbins-Klein. I'm author of The Thoughtful Leader and host of the Thoughtful Leader podcast. Thoughtful leadership is all about thought leadership that goes above and beyond. Thought leadership that is truly new and original, exciting, disruptive, maybe even groundbreaking. Because let's face it, we need to raise the bar. My guests and I are absolutely obsessed with finding truly original thought leadership, and I'm going to bring you so many exciting ideas and opportunities, things for you to think about, and chances for you to push your thinking that you'll be very glad you tuned in. So thanks so much for checking out Thoughtful Leadership and the Thoughtful Leader podcast. I look forward to connecting with you very, very soon. Welcome to the show. My guest today is the amazing thoughtful leader, Nigel Risner. I have known him for about 20 years, and I was about to say he never changes. The good aspects never change. And let's see what he has to say today. Hello, Nigel.
Good afternoon. How are you?
I am very well. It's really great to pin you down for this podcast. I know you're a busy man, loads of clients. Tell everybody a little bit about what you do, however you want to describe yourself.
So I'm a motivational speaker, inspirational speaker, business coach, but now more known as the Chief Zookeeper. That all came about because of my communication style and writing a book about, well, the book's called It's a Zoo Around Here. So we look at all aspects of people and we divide everyone into one of four categories. So you're either a monkey, elephant, lion, or a dolphin. And then more and more people have just labeled me as the zookeeper. Now I get chocolate sent to me as the Chief Zookeeper, or in my case, the Chief Monkey Officer, because labeling people is not complicated, but being a zookeeper is unbelievably complicated. So people who've done Myers-Briggs, Belvin, DISC, Insight, they're all brilliant, but the problem is they're all not brilliant in the sense that what happens is, including my own, you know, what you find out is who you are. You're a lemon, you're a tomato, you're a driver, whatever it is. That doesn't really help you with the rest of the world. So the zookeeper analogy is, imagine everyone's in a cage and you want to feed them the right food. The only person who does that well is a zookeeper. Same as when you write books, you know, you're writing a book for the readers, not for the person who wrote the book. And if you're a zookeeper and you were writing, you'd make sure everyone who was reading the book would understand it in their language.
Well, I'm sure you're an amazing zookeeper. And I've been at some events where you've had to manage a room of unruly participants, and as well as others. I think I'm a monkey as well. I remember doing that in one of your sessions. We're here today talking about thoughtful leadership, and this is going to be interesting. I'm probably going to pick up on the monkey theme again. Thank you for reminding me. The monkey isn't normally seen as the one who sits and reflects and is thoughtful. Am I right?
Well, so here's the problem. So the entrepreneur leader is normally a monkey who's got a great idea, but sometimes doesn't quite know how to fulfill the idea because he needs a team. The lion leader is normally what we'd assume as the thoughtful leader. The problem is they're not that thoughtful. They have an idea. They run their team in a draconian style where it's their way or no way. Then you have the elephant who is much more thoughtful, but isn't necessarily loud enough and entrepreneurial enough to follow through the dream because he's so into his thought and process that he's not out there sharing the vision. And then you have the dolphin leader, which is a problem because they're much more nurturing, caring, and supportive. And very few dolphins, or what I call HR, have ever become a CEO. So it's really interesting that a thoughtful leader in theory should be the zookeeper. Should be. The problem is the deeper thought process means sometimes they're inactive. They play the game of perfection. Thoughtful leaders aren't perfectionists. They are excellent leaders. And there's a big difference between perfection and excellence. The problem is sometimes you get so stuck in your thought, and then that problem of, you know, where do we go from here, that you never actually get going because you're so much in process. There's a lovely line that says, you can't aim a duck to death. I'll repeat that for you. You can't aim a duck to death. At some point, you've got to fire. The problem is people like me, we just fire randomly and hope. The thoughtful leader actually looks at the picture, looks at the vision, decides where they're going. But at some point, you've got to pull a trigger. That's scary for lots of people because thoughtful leaders, in theory, use their heart and their head. But sometimes you get stuck in your head for too long, or you just go with your gut. It is very rare that if you thought about the thoughtful leader, you really should be saying the zookeeper who is thoughtful. If the truth be known. So if we did a book together, that's what it would have to be called, the thoughtful zookeeper, or the zookeeper who was thoughtful. Because it's tough leadership, because you have to think about the process. But if a phenomenal 24-carat bold position occurred, or there was this massive opportunity, you can't go too deep. You've just got to run with it. So you've got that balance between thoughtfulness and that phenomenal idea.
Thank you for using some of my favorite words and mentioning some of my favorite books that I've written.
Because that's what zookeepers do. They look around and see, what does the person you're talking to want to hear? Because I could talk about other books and you'd be going, well, I've written about this. So if you're really thoughtful and you understand the person you're talking to, and that's the problem with communication, that most people, when they're under pressure, go back to their natural style. Thoughtful leaders think about the person they're speaking to. They have to stop for a second and go, what does that person want? So I'm big into Cadbury's chocolate, as you know. Sending me Bourneville is not only wasted, it's disrespectful to me. I don't drink. Sending me phenomenal champagne is wasted because I don't drink. The problem is the leader thinks, not the thoughtful leader, the leader thinks, well, champagne will be interesting, or a box of Lindt chocolate will be great, because that's what they want. Someone sends me a Cadbury's bar of chocolate with Diet Coke. To me, they're the most thoughtful leader in the world. But you've got to know your animal. You've got to know the person you're dealing with.
Absolutely. Well, Nigel also used the word balance. I hope you guys heard him, because, of course, I write and speak about balance all the time. And in The Thoughtful Leader, one of the favorite sections that I wrote is about how long is a piece of thinking. And so you're spot on that it's a balance between not thinking at all, you know, ready, fire, aim, or I don't know why I've used that, because I was about to tell you off for using a shooting metaphor, but still,
I use that a lot, ready, fire, aim.
Because
that's the point. At some point, you need to be ready, you need to think, but the problem is, once you're fired, you can re-aim. But most people are so stuck in procrastination. They're so stuck in perfection, because, you know, I don't know if you've read any of Brené Brown stuff, but she says women, more than men, by the way, are so scared of getting it wrong, and they don't voice an opinion in the boardroom because they don't want to look silly. Whereas men often will just share because we can cope with rejection. Thoughtful leaders think about what needs to be shared, but some leaders are so nervous about how they're going to be perceived that they actually either don't say anything or do anything. You can never get it wrong if you don't do anything. That's the point. The problem is there's no success without doing something.
Actually, you can get it wrong if you sit and do nothing, because the next thing is someone else is promoted over your head, or you're made redundant. Doing something is really good. You know, leadership in general is something that, you know, I work with. We have colleagues who work in the leadership area. My reason for writing The Thoughtful Leader, as you know, was to take a pop at the thought leader phrase, and the fact that everybody was throwing around the phrase thought leader. And sometimes there wasn't enough thought put into it. What are your thoughts on that, Nigel?
Well, it's really interesting, because if you're a systematic, reference-orientated leader where you need evidence and social proof, it's great, but at some point, entrepreneurs have to take some risks. So you look at a Richard Branson, you look at an Elon Musk, you look at someone who's out there. I mean, Gerald Ratner, who made one statement, because I knew exactly what I was thinking. I was actually at that conference. I was doing a breakout session at the time, and I know exactly what he meant to say, but he was just speaking from his own heart, And it was taken so out of context that the world went against him. Then you look at a Richard Branson, who makes sure he employs brilliant, thoughtful leaders. He is not a thoughtful leader in any shape or form, but he employs brilliant leaders. He employs people who can look at a situation. I think the world has gone a little bit crazy. We are so worried about upsetting everybody. You know, there was the Friends reunion on TV yesterday, and somebody made a comment saying, it's not very racially balanced. Well, you know, first of all, it's a program 25 years ago, but nor was, you know, the Prince of Bel-Air, nor was the Cosby Show. But no one says that. So there's a point where you have to look at the world, and it would be lovely if everything was gender balanced. But that's just not the real world today. I'm not saying it's right or it's wrong, but you need to look at a situation and go, how can I do the best that I can in the situation I'm in to improve the lives of as many people as possible? You're still going to piss off 2%, whatever you do. And you've heard me speak many times. I know I'm Marmite Speaker of the Year for 20-odd years. There's a group of people, it doesn't matter what I say, are not going to like what I'm going to say. But I've worked with over 2.5 million people. So if 10%, which is 250,000, don't get it, trust me, I'd love them to love me. But doesn't Leo Biscali had a phenomenal quote. He said, you can be the most impeccable peach in the world, but some people don't like peaches. Well, what more can you say? You know, at some level, a thoughtful leader wants to think about what they're saying. And if you go to the next position about claiming your position as a top expert in your field, even if you are the top expert in your field, people have a vested interest in your life not working. So you can get right to the top. And there's a small group of people who don't want to see you succeed. So you just have to think from your heart and think, is what I'm going to do going to make the biggest impact? Nobody wants to upset people. I don't believe people come to work to do a bad job. But there's still a group of people, doesn't matter what you do, are going to go, it didn't float my boat. Well, what can you say?
Oh, wow. So you obviously have either been listening to the podcast, reading the books, or reading my mind. I know, all of the above. What I'm wondering, and I know you're not going to be afraid to answer this question, is have you ever got it wrong? Have you made an error of judgment that you're willing to share on this podcast? Because many of the other guests have. It's up to you, of course. But talk about how it worked out, if you do talk about a mistake.
Look, I'm on stage occasionally, and my brain works at a certain level. And I remember introducing a young lady on stage, and I don't normally MC, but I was so impressed with what this woman had achieved and did that what I was actually meaning to say was, I can't believe how she does all this in her day. But it came across as I was being not demeaning of her, but like, how can a woman do all this? And how can she run a family? And how can she live her life? And how does she have 5 kids? And how does she walk the dog? And it appeared to some of the audience, I was being a male chauvinist pig and I didn't understand women. Well, that was the furthest thing from my mind. And occasionally now when I'm speaking, I'm having to think, is what I'm going to share going to land? Because this is going to sound so strange. I swear to God, I love people. I want people to be unstoppable. I want them to be the best version of themselves. All the stuff that most motivational speakers would share. But occasionally you just let rip. And you say a phrase because your brain is working. And then you think, someone will say, I don't think you meant that. So about 6 weeks ago or 7 weeks ago, I said on a Zoom presentation, I've now been at home for a year and I've never slept with my wife. I've never slept with the same woman for 100 nights in a row type of thing. I know what I meant to say. I've never been at home for 100 nights. It came across like I've never slept with the same woman for 100 nights. And I know exactly what they were thinking after I said it, but it's interesting how there is a community out there who are looking for men or women, by the way, whether it's gender, race, religion, to pick up on a word that you might get wrong. So when people who know me, I know I've said some stuff on stage. I mean, I've used the F word on stage. I've said the C word on stage. I've never said the N word on stage because I've really thought about it. But there's a time where my own coach said to me, any word you use is just a word. It depends how it's interpreted. The problem is, because of social media, and you know I said this phrase probably 15 years ago, so I'm going to repeat it. I said, there aren't that many great women keynote speakers on the stage today and who are performing on a regular basis. It got quoted that I said, women aren't good speakers. That's not what I said at all. But I had to defend myself. And still today, when you look at conferences, there aren't that many women on the stage. So I get myself in trouble because I'm just sharing from the heart what I feel. I don't want to have to go to that place of thoughtfulness in every word that I'm saying, because then I'm not being me.
Wow. So that's a whole new dimension to this work, because the balance is very important, not to overthink, but, you know, to put some thought into what you want others to call thought leadership. What really gets me, as you know, Nigel, is people writing and speaking and either calling their own stuff thought leadership, or calling themselves thought leaders, or, you know, expecting that it's just going to be called thought leadership. I'm sorry, thought leadership is meant to be original, exciting, disruptive, something new, not same old, but let's call it thought leadership. So that's, I'm railing against that. I have to talk to you, and actually the listeners have no idea about this. I'm going to reveal it for the first time. Da-da-da. I have a new hashtag. I know. I have a hashtag that I've asked our PR agency to use wherever possible and wherever relevant when they're talking about me. And it is hashtag woke and proud. Now, this is very controversial, and I've picked up on this because of what you've been talking about and this whole, you know, politically correct wokeness. I was called woke and I had to look it up because, you know, I thought, I'm awake. Yes, I'm not sleeping. And funny enough, that is what it means to me. And I'm woke and proud because I'm willing to call out a true instance of racism or abuse against women or any minority or, you know, inequity in society. I want to call out unresourceful behavior and language. So for me, that's woke, and people don't like it, but they can go too far. That's what I hear you saying, right?
Look, I get, you know, I come from a Jewish family. I understand racism, anti-Semitism, and all of that stuff. But there comes a point where, you know, Tottenham fans shout out a single word on every single match. It's bizarre. I'm not sure they know what they're saying. There's people that, you know, whether you're a Londoner, whether you're a Cockney, whether you're a Northerner, you know, whether you're Scottish, whether you're female, there are certain phrases that get used. The problem is it's the context that it's used. And if you know the person, you know, I'm not saying older generations got away with it and older TV programs didn't know better. But today, there is a tiny percentage of people who might be racist, anti-Semitic, who are male, female, gender, whatever it might be. But when you say everyone is wrong and everyone does this, I find that hard to believe. And I don't dispute that there are times where my daughter, who is 31, looks at me and says, Dad, you can't say that. I hear her, so I then correct myself. But I don't want to get thrown under the bus for one phrase that I might use. Because unfortunately, I'm 59 a couple of weeks' time. I've been using that phrase for 50 years. You need time to undo your own language, but I totally appreciate we need to start thinking about the world in a different way.
Well, we have begun to think about the world in a different way. I'm the eternal optimist. I see a lot of great progress having been made in our society, not just in the business context where you and I spend most of our time, but, you know, in every aspect. I think in general, there's more good than bad or more resourcefulness than the opposite. The thing that interests me, and we don't have that much time left, but I have to ask you this question. Where do you think more thoughtfulness is really needed today? You can talk about a sector. You can talk about, you know, a person. Be careful, though.
No, I love this question because I am an advocate of trust in the workplace. So there's a lovely quote, which I'm just going to read out, which says, if you trusted an individual enough to hire them, you should trust them enough to get their work done when and wherever they want. So we've got this big issue right now about work from home, work at home, and then the office. And so because of the pandemic, you had 20 million people that weren't customer facing. So a bus driver has to meet the public. You know, if you're a shopkeeper selling newspapers, you might be able to do some stuff online, but in theory, you're customer facing. For 10 million people in theory who worked in offices, they were able to do something in a different way. Now, I don't dispute collaboration, communication, community is important, but you don't need all 10 million people all going back to the office tomorrow. So for me, the way forward in a way is to think about your people, love your people, communicate with your people, be thoughtful with your people and decide, how do we make the best use of their time? How do we allow people to be trusted to do their job, but more importantly, to enjoy their job? You know, we're lucky in a way that, you know, we've been able to use Zoom for this interview. We didn't have to travel to do it. It would have been nicer. We could have had a cup of tea. But the idea that one of us might have had to travel an hour to do what we've done here is one thing. The idea, though, that people are going to fly in for an interview when you could do it this way. However, conferences, exhibitions, workplace, meeting your team, looking at your colleagues, literally, I mean, Zoom means I can see right into your eyes, by the way. But what's interesting is that when you have 50 or 100 people on Zoom, there's a bit where there's no break. And, you know, when you leave a meeting, you've literally left the computer. So I think the world needs to recognize we don't all have to be in an office together, but we do need to see each other. We don't all have to go onto a Zoom, but we do need to have some face-to-face contact. But it's going to be very interesting the next 6 months. I mean, you've just seen, the, you know, two of the biggest accountancy firms, you know, Ernst & Young have said, you never need to come back to the office. And Deloitte has said, at least 2 days a week, you don't have to be in the office. Now, these are major players. But if you are customer facing, it's a different story.
Very, very true. And our team has always been distributed virtual. We used to meet up when we could, but of course, the past year and a half, you know, hasn't happened. So we've done socials, we've done extra events, we're doing something fun, which I can't talk about here.
If you think about how many books you've been able to produce without physically meeting, it's probably not that dissimilar to when you could have met in the same sense. Obviously, it pays to meet people so you can feel their soul. But you've got to find other ways so that you can help someone's book in Australia and they don't have to fly over here so you can feel them. You can do it in a different way.
Yeah, and our team is virtual and always has been. And the funny thing, Nigel, is I wasn't thoughtful about it. It's just the way it worked out. I had three or four team members based in and around North London and Hertfordshire, where I am. But we, through historical reasons, we had a Cornwall team. I have someone in the States. We were never going to have the whole team together in one place. We did have almost everybody at some London Book Fair meetings, but still not everybody. We did what we could. But the funny thing is, when we spoke to potential investors, they always said, you know, where's your team and where's your office? And, you know, they thought we were less than because we didn't have an office. Well, I think that we've benefited because we didn't have those overheads and we didn't have, you know, all the things that, like you say, somebody traveling an hour, maybe not being at their best when they're there. So, you know, there were benefits as well. I would like to finish up. Oh, by the way, we had a few weeks ago on the podcast, Anne Franca, who I'm sure you know, is the CEO of the CMI. And she was talking about the exact same topic about how to support people and does it need to be the old way? This pandemic was a real shakeup.
Just for the record, yeah. One of the issues is going to be if you're not seen by old style management, because this is where we're not a thought leader, we're now old style management. If you're not being seen, are you really working? So there's going to be a promotion issue for some people that if you're not being seen in the normal way, are you going to be left out? But if you are being seen, does that mean you're doing the job just as well as someone who isn't being seen? So in the next 6 months, we're going to see a really diverse workplace because most old style managers want to come into an office because they feel that's the way leadership is done. And just for the record, we lead people and we manage things. So the old style managers don't understand you don't need to lead people that way. And leaders need to recognize that managers manage facilities, not people.
That is about it for today. I wish we could talk forever. I know you could talk forever and so could I. But what I'd like for you to do is just sum this up with one piece of advice for the people listening to us now. So what is it you would advise every listener to do? Over to you, Nigel.
The one thing I would suggest people do is to look at trust and their gut. So I suggest everyone has, it's a new probably book for you, a gut diary. So it's to look at a situation, write down your initial thought from a gut reaction. So you have the vagus nerve, which goes from the back of your brain right down to the base of your stomach. And it's the largest nerve in your body. And recognize that your gut is 97% right. The problem is because we don't record our gut, we don't trust our gut. That way, your meetings could be half the time. Your friendship reactions could be half. Because there are times you meet someone and you think, this is not going to be right. And you're normally proved right. You could have an idea for a brand new book and you think, sounds a bit nuts, but I think it could work. Well, then write down in your gut diary, will work. 21 days later and 42 days later, look at your diary and I promise you, you'll be 90% accurate.
Nigel Risner, wise as the elephant that he is not, fun as the monkey that he is. And you guys can find him, all of his bio contact details and show notes are below. So you can enjoy connecting with him, nigelrisner.com, and all of his fun handles and social media. And I just want to thank you again for spending time with us today on the Thoughtful Leader podcast.
Thank you for trusting me and allowing me to be with you.
I hope you've enjoyed this episode of The Thoughtful Leader, and I hope it's inspired you to be more thoughtful as a leader in your business. Please consider subscribing and leaving a review. An important question for you. Do you want to create a culture of thought leadership in your organization? My best-selling book, The Thoughtful Leader, is available now on Amazon and many other sites in paperback, ebook, and audiobook formats. Please visit www.mindygk.com for more great content. That's www.mindygk.com. Speak to you again soon.